3, 2, 1.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I am your host, Richard Allinger. In this, the presentation of Lessons in Church History, Richard Allinger presents Lessons in Church History. In previous broadcasts, I had been talking to you about different religious events that had taken place back around the time of the American Civil Rights, the great American Civil Rights leader Martin Luther King Jr. and his assassination, speaking out about the injustice of racial segregation in America. It was around that time that also, you know, the civil rights leader, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., was not the only one speaking out against that, but he also spoke out against the Vietnam War, and his voice wasn't the only voice that was speaking out against the Vietnam War at that time, in the late 60s and early 70s, when I began to talk to you about different events that were going on in previous broadcasts of Richard Allinger Presents, whose programs are all archived on YouTube. And you can go there and just put Richard Allinger Presents in the search boxes and find previous programs, so I won't be too repetitious on covering everything, but things that I have not covered, I have to cover in our program today with this time restraints. My sessions are like 30 minutes, two 30-minute sessions, so I have to be kind of succinct and to the point and not too verbose to get the information conveyed to you that needs to be conveyed to you before I can get into other pertinent church history with regard to what has happened here in Flint, Michigan. Now, as you know, January 16th, which is next week, will be Martin Luther King's birthday observed, a national observance. We are celebrating his legacy and his life and all that he accomplished at the First Trinity Missionary Baptist Church, downtown Flint, on the 16th Monday morning. And the illustrious Dr. Marion Hockenhall and the First Lady, Ezra Tillman's First Lady and wife, will be working together as a warm host at the celebration of the late Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King there at First Trinity. Now, with regard to keeping his dream alive, I spoke with you how the Treasury, Department of Treasury, has put the dreamer like Moses, the dreamer like Joseph, and the prophet like Moses, Dr. Martin Luther King, on a Series I savings bond to keep his dream alive. And different residential streets have been named after Dr. King, and expressways and cities and different buildings to keep his dream alive, that all Jews and Gentiles would live together in peace, love, and harmony. And so I'd like to see you there if you can possibly attend on the 16th Monday, next week, January, at First Trinity and Missionary Baptist Church on Beach Street. But during the Vietnam War era, Dr. King spoke out against that war when it wasn't popular to do so. And there was also a local theologian and cleric, the Reverend Bernard Gill, who also spoke out against that war through his pulpit. And in previous sessions, I had been trying to acquaint you with this man, because much that goes on in the body of Christ are people that nobody knows. And a lot of things that people do are only known unto God the Father. And this man, Bernard Gill, didn't get the news media too much in coverage about what he was doing, but he was speaking out against the war. He was seeing some apostasy and corruption in the Protestant denominations, like Martin Luther did in the Reformation back in the 16th century. And Bernard Gill was a lot like Martin Luther, who spoke out against apostasy and corruption in the Roman Catholic Church 500 years ago. And acquainting you with this man, Bernard Gill, the reason that I was going to do that in these lessons of church history is because there was a man in Flint that I'm trying to acquaint you with named Bernard Gill instead of Martin Luther. And this is a book that just came out, The Legacy of Luther, and it was edited by Dr. R.C. Sproles, and it says that This book is a timely reminder that the church of our generation, I mean up here in the 21st century, needs to be reformed anew. We desperately need someone like Luther to lift the banner up, the gospel banner high. Well, that's why Martin Luther King spoke out against racial injustice, because the organized churches were not doing it, which their silence was an indictment against them. And like Luther, back 500 years ago, you know, he lifted the banner of the gospel high to shake worldly evangelicals out of their blind spiritual stupor and declare a war on the devil in Christ's name. Now, this is just one theologian's remarks about this book on Martin Luther. And just on a quick review of the book, this just came off the press, meet Martin Luther. He was one of the most influential men of his day. The movement that began with his posting of the 95 Theses reshaped Europe, redirected Christian history, and recovered the truth of God's Word. 500 years later, what is Luther's legacy is in this volume, edited by Dr. Sproles and 13 other scholars and pastors examine the life, teaching, and enduring influence. Meet Martin Luther in the audacious reformer who, out of his love for truth and the desire to bring it into light, set the world ablaze. And they say that 16th century Protestant Reformation is a fire that will never be extinguished. It was started by those reformers. And as you know, because that happened 500 years ago, books like this right here, Is the Reformation Over? An Evangelical Assessment of the Contemporary Roman Catholic Catholicism by Mark Knoll and Carolyn Nystrom is being written too. And I will be speaking with you on issues about that later, but there was a man in Flint, Michigan that back around the time Dr. King was assassinated that began to pray for Flint, and he spoke out in his pulpit at the Colonial Village Pentecostal Church of the Nazarene, located at 925 West Atherton Road. When you'd go by that church, you would see a clock tower, and when you looked up to the clock tower, there was a cross at the steeple's tip. And when you looked to see what time it was, underneath the hands of the clock was the words, with lights flashing, running out. He wanted to people to know, looking at his church, that time is running out. And I cover this with you because I wanted you to capture the sense, the ambience of that moment that this man was here, because he was here and then he wasn't here. I mean, he was in the news, but then he died. And hardly no one in Flint knew anything about what he was talking about. And he, like I said, he was like Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. speaking out against the Vietnam War too, when it wasn't popular to do so. Now, walking into his church from the street, I spoke in previous programs about how it was to walk in the front door, hang your coat up, and go through the sanctuary doors and see different track racks. And as you begin to go down to sit down in a pew, you notice that behind the pews were church hymnals with a lot of the great hymns of the Christian faith. They were there. There was a organ on one side of the pulpit down in front of the sanctuary altar. There was an altar down by the pulpit. There was an organ on one side of the pulpit and a piano on the other side of the pulpit with organ and piano players. And up on the sanctuary wall was the words, "Feed my sheep." When you are born again and become part of the kingdom of God, you follow Jesus and you're one of his sheep. Jesus said, "Many sheep have I, not of this fold, but other folds that he will bring into the kingdom of God as well." And he is the good shepherd, Jesus Christ. And also across the, on the other side of the wall where it had, down there in front of the sanctuary where it had "Feed my sheep," what brought me to this particular location and to meet this particular man, Bernard Gill, was my mother had clipped an article out of the paper, Flint Journal, that he claims to have heard the audible voice of God the Father, who told his earlier prophet Noah to build an ark. So that's why I went to the church to meet this man. And they had down there onto written on the wall the words, God, in quotation marks, onto my prophet, right? And then it would, as you begin to sit down in the pew, you begin to get the impression, having never met the man personally, but seeing him down there sitting in pulpit furniture behind the pulpit before he got up to deliver a message in the worship service after the songs and hymns were a congregational singing was going on, then he would get up and bring a message out of the Bible. That you get the impression that he actually is dictated to by the Holy Spirit and hears the audible voice of God the Father. Then, like I said, behind the pulpit was a baptistry scene where they baptized people, full immersion, with a stained glass window of John the Baptist in water up to his waist, baptizing Jesus with the Holy Spirit dove coming down. And also the Father speaking, this is my beloved Son, hear ye him. There was the three persons of the Holy Trinity were there in the Jordan River that day that John the Baptist baptized Jesus. Your mind was reminded or called to that as you sat down in the pews. And then there would be a warm welcome by the choir director as he got up and warmly welcomed everybody to the service, and they began singing songs like Great is Thy Faithfulness and Amazing Grace, and he could have called 10,000 angels to destroy the world but died alone for you and me, and different songs of Christ and his love for mankind and his sufferings, and very moving service. And then we were told, as we met this man that was going to be bringing this message, that what it said in the newspaper, that God the Father had spoken in longer dialogues to this man than he did his earlier prophet Moses, hearing the voice of God the Father who thundered from Sinai and gave Moses the two tablets of the Ten Commandments. And also there was an article in the paper that my sister Mary Beth, my younger sister, I'm one of 11 children, and Mary Beth was my youngest sister, and she attended Eisenhower Elementary School. My parents lived right down there by Eisenhower School, Hammerburg and Miller Road area. And Mary Beth, after she went through Eisenhower School Elementary, they put her in Zimmerman Junior High School, and there was a boy that lived in the neighborhood down there named Gene Barlow, and he evidently had been playing down by the Flint River where the GMI or Kettering University was at, and he had drowned it. He was only a 12-year-old boy in junior high school with my sister, and nobody knew where he was at, his parents. And so the voices spoke to this pastor, Reverend Bernard Gill, who said he was a prophet of God. Actually, he said God spoke to him and told him where the dead boy's body was at. And he called the sheriff's department. This was before Sheriff Pickell was Genesee County Sheriff. I think it was Joe Wilson, if I remember correctly, when Jim Rutherford was the former mayor of Flint around that time, and Joe Wilson was the sheriff. And remember when, around that, back in the late 60s, early 70s, Dr. Martin Luther King was assassinated, and speaking out against the war, and this man here in his pulpit was speaking out against the war, which was kind of startling to me, because, you know, when I would see somebody like the world-renowned, famous evangelist Billy Graham, he would be playing golf with Richard Nixon and wouldn't be talking about, you know, why America shouldn't be in the war. And I just thought this man was kind of different than the Reverend Billy Graham. He was more like Martin Luther King, speaking out against the war when it wasn't popular to do so, from his pulpit. And upon reading about how he actually informed the sheriff department, this is all documented in their records, where the dead boy's body was at, the deputies went and drug the Flint River with hooks down there by where GMI or Kettering University's at, and sure enough, they found the dead boy's body. And then has in a paper, a woman in the church where this Reverend Gill was preaching had been she had been without hearing in one ear most of her life, but she was miraculously restored to hearing there. So one of her deaf ears was restored, her hearing in one of her ears. And with all of these different reports of what was going on, people had the sense that God was with his people. And this was a time frame I told you of the unpopular nuclear, the unpopular Vietnam War. And as you know, I'm a Vietnam veteran in the Marine Corps at that time. And from 68 to 70, I was taken out of the neighborhood to go to Vietnam. I was in Quang Tri and Chu Lai and Phu Bai, about Dong Ha, 10 miles south of the DMZ, for 13 months. And when I came back, this is when my mother had told me about this Reverend Bernard Gill in the neighborhood that lived down there on Pershing Street, four doors down from my mom and dad, and his church was over on Atherton Road. She had clipped the article out and told me, why don't you go, you know, attend this particular service and inquire of this man. And so I went to there, and because it was the time frame of the Vietnam War and the anti-war movement that was going on, and all of the Watergate issue at the Democratic National Convention. If you remember the presidential election of 1972, when the former 37th president Richard Nixon ran against the South Dakota Senator George McGovern, this Bernard Gill actually was involved in sending messages from God through the Western Union down to the Oval Office. And this was in addition to all the different miracles locally that were taking place, and seeing how this particular minister and the format of his ministry was impressing me, I could not believe the things my ears was hearing about. Well, for instance, Richard Nixon, the former 37th president of the United States, back in this time frame, when I began to meet this Nazarene, Pentecostal Nazarene minister, Richard Nixon believed that the Democrats were in collusion with other anti-war movement factions of our society, and as president, he believed that he had the executive privilege to bug the Democratic National Headquarters at the Watergate complex in Washington, D.C. in the presidential election year of 1972. And I guess these were covert operations. And when it came out after the election, in the congressional investigations chaired by Senator Sam Ervin, South Carolina senator, the investigation revealed that Richard Nixon had ordered the bugging of the Democratic National Headquarters at the Watergate complex, but he, instead of confessing this to the nation, had the CIA cover it up, that he was the one that instigated the bugging. And I guess because of Richard Nixon's involvement in this bugging of the Democratic National Headquarters at the Watergate complex in this time frame, that the congressional committees prepared three articles of impeachment on the former 37th president, which was abuse of power, contempt of Congress, and obstruction of justice, and they were going to actually impeach Richard Nixon on these three articles of impeachment. But has this unfolded, it was kind of like a long national nightmare that was going on. They let him resign with honor instead of infamously impeaching him. And during this time, I was being seated in the pew, going to hear what this man, Bernard Gill, was having to say. And before he did talk about the Word of God and bring the message from the Bible, he expressed anger toward what was going on in the government in Washington, D.C., and he said that the Lord from heaven would have nobody in or near Washington be president, who was even running for president at the time. And he said God instructed him, because they didn't have like email back then or Twitter or social media, So he sent at the expense of $50 per telegram back in May 13th of 1973, and June 4th of 1973, two telegrams telling Richard Nixon that, well, Bernard Gill said, "I, Mr. President, voted for you in the 1972 election, but then when God's word came to me as his prophet that you were guilty in this ugliness of bugging the Democratic National Headquarters after you won the election from Senator, the South Dakota Senator George McGovern in the presidential election of November 1972, when it came out in 73 in those Watergate congressional investigations, the Lord gave me my daughter." Pastor Gill said, "My daughter Jeanette was actually invited to your inauguration. I voted for you, Mr. President, but when word came to me from the Lord that you had instigated the bugging, and he told me to ask you to go before America and confess that you did this, and if you would do this, he would forgive you." And but Richard Nixon, or whoever received these telegrams, twice it was sent to the White House. They did receive them because the Secret Service actually visited the parsonage where Pastor Gill lived, because they wanted to check him out, and was wondering, why did you send these telegrams telling Mr. Nixon that he was guilty in this bugging of the Democratic National Headquarters? And you said that the Lord from heaven was going to expose him in his trying to cover it up through the CIA if he didn't confess it himself. Well, he didn't confess it, and he had different CIA agents confess that they were the ones that did it, and it kind of covered up the fact that Richard Nixon was the one that instigated it in the first place, thinking he was justified to do that in the name of national security, thinking that the Democrats were in secret collusion with other factions of the anti-war movement in our country, which actually led to his impeachment, abuse of power, contempt of Congress, and obstruction of justice had he not been granted the privilege of resigning in August of 1974, which he did. And this brought about, at that time, his vice president, Spiro Agnew, was indicted for tax evasion, and where he was governor in Maryland, so his office was vacant. The president's office was vacant, and the constitutional protocol calls for the Speaker of the House to be the president upon the removal of the president, no vice president. But Mr. McCormick was, I think, 70 years old, and his family physician said that he was in no condition actually to be commander-in-chief at the time. He probably couldn't handle it with his heart's condition. So constitutional protocol says that you got to move down to the majority whip of the House, which would be none other than ours here in Michigan, Grand Rapids Representative Gerald R. Ford. He was the majority whip, and so they made him president of the United States. He was one of the few presidents that actually, in the history of the United States in the last 240 years, actually was appointed president through constitutional protocol with the removal of our president and vice president, and the Speaker of the House unable to actually be in any physical condition to be the commander-in-chief. And then Gerald Ford, in August of 1974, was sworn in as the 38th President of the United States to finish out the four-year term of Richard Nixon. And I guess he had appointed New York's Governor Nelson Rockefeller to run be his vice, but in the last minute of this particular session, I'll tell you that it took Congress from August of 74 to December of 74 to even approve Nelson Rockefeller to be Gerald Ford's vice president, because he had so much interest in oil companies and so on, and they didn't know if it would that they could approve him being the president, the vice president under Gerald Ford. Well, they did approve him, and Nelson Rockefeller was sworn in as Gerald Ford's vice president in December of 1974. Well, it's time for station identification with FACT, F-A-C-T, Flint Area Community Television, Channel 17 on Comcast Cable. We're going to have a station identification and also some commercials that will greatly benefit you, the viewing audience, and I hope you can join me back so I can continue these lessons in church history.
Only on public access.
Read to a child today and spark a lifetime of ambition.
Teach. teacher and teaching all the sleepers. Teacher, be kind and be in your mind. Please say hi, don't forget bye. Teacher, be kind and be in your mind. Please say hi, don't forget bye.
My name is Anaya, my game is on fire. Every day I jump, way more higher. My game is on with my shades on. Every day is a game, so I gotta play go.
We told you that we're gonna go.
The future of our generation, it all lies on you. So you gotta make the best of it, you know what you gotta do. You gotta go to school to learn and get lots of knowledge, so you can pass school and make it on to college. I wanna be a magician, amaze everyone I meet. Do magic everywhere, even on the streets. So you better clap when I am coming near, because if you don't, then I'll make you disappear.
My name is Keon, I like video games. It's really cool, no, it's not lame. I be breaking all the records every single day. You try to beat me, but there's no way. When I get older, I wanna create my own game, and everyone will know my name.
For my career, I wanna be a lawyer. I wanna be the boss, not an employer. You can see me on TV, no Law and Order. I wanna be the greatest, like Mike Jordan. And I wanna be a good father, cause being a father is important.
Oh, I'm so glad that you could get back with me, because I wanted to go to the Old Testament, Daniel chapter 9, to in those telegrams that the Reverend Bernard Gill had sent down to Washington, D.C. to the Nixon administration, imploring President Nixon to confess to the American people that he ordered the bugging of the Democratic National Headquarters. And he left this message, Daniel chapter 9, verse 14, in that telegram. And it says in the Old Testament, "Therefore hath the Lord watched upon the evil and brought it upon us, for the Lord our God is righteous in all his works which he doeth, for we obeyed not his voice." So that was the message that was sent down to Washington with that telegram about listening to the Holy Spirit and God. Because if you don't listen to him, then it says right here, "Therefore hath the Lord watched upon the evil by not listening to him, and brought it upon us, for the Lord our God is righteous in all his works which he does, for we obeyed not his voice." Now, in the previous session, I told you what it was like to go into this man's church. Most churches were silent about the government's involvement in politics and the civil rights movement, and they didn't really talk about that. But this man actually was speaking out against the war in Vietnam and racial segregation, just like Martin Luther King was. This Nazarene, Pentecostal Nazarene minister, he was really different. And as you turned around after listening to his message out of the Bible and his apparent anger toward the people in the government down in Washington, you would walk out the back door, and as you walked out the front door of the church, standing up, going up the aisle, and walking out of the church to get in the parking lot to get in your car, as you were walking out, you would see on one side of the door, the wall, on the back door going out, you would see like the words written on the wall, many, many tikkel yufarsin, them are Hebrew words taken out of the Old Testament Bible on one side of the wall, and then on the other side of the wall, on the other side of the door going out to the parking lot, it said there was a picture of like balances, and on one balance that was heavier and more weight was the cross dripping in blood of Christ, and then man was on the other side of the balance. With these words, many, many, tikkel yufarsin. And see, everything that, you know, Christ and his blood outweighs anything that man can do. And so, it says right here, these words that were taken out of Daniel chapter 5 of the Old Testament, it says, that was on that sanctuary wall over there on Atherton Road in that church where that man who was a prophet spoke, it said, the writing interpreted, then Daniel, chapter 5, verse 17, then Daniel answered and said before the king, let thy gifts be to thyself and give thy rewards to another. Yet I will read the writing unto the king and make known to him the interpretation. O thou king, the most high God, gave Nebuchadnezzar thy father a kingdom and majesty and glory and honor. And then he was actually going back, Daniel, reviewing to King Belshazzar at this feast where this handwriting, mini, mini, tikkel yufarsin, appeared miraculously. A hand was writing that on the wall in Hebrew. And he was telling Nebuchadnezzar's son, who was king at that time, and thou, his son, O Belshazzar, hast not humbled thine heart, though thou knowest all these things, but hast lifted up thyself against the Lord of heaven, and they have brought the vessels of his house before thee, and thou, and thy lords, thy wives, and thy concubines have drunk wine in them, and thou hast praised the goods of silver and gold, of brass, iron, wood, and stone, which see not, which hear nor know, and the God in whose hand thy breath is, and whose all are thy ways, hast thou not glorified. Then was the part of the hand sent from him, and this writing was written. And this is the writing that was written. Many, many, tikkel yufarsin. This is the interpretation of the thing. Many, God hath numbered thy kingdom and finished it. Tikkel, thou art weighed in the balances and art found wanting. Peres, thy kingdom is divided and given to the Medes and Persians. Then commanded Belshazzar, and they clothed Daniel with scarlet and put a chain of gold about his neck and made a proclamation concerning him that he should be the third ruler in the kingdom. In that night, Belshazzar, the king of the Chaldeans, was slain, and Darius and the Medes took the kingdom, being about 80 years old. So this same writing was written on the sanctuary wall in Reverend Gill's church with the balances of Christ and his cross outweighing the man that was in that balance. Many, many, tikkel yufarsin, thou art weighed in the balances and found wanting. So you got the impression that the Lord from heaven was not really happy with the American government of this time. And as you begin to walk out of the church after hearing the message and seeing this man talk like he did, the words he had. Gerald Ford, a year before he was appointed president of the United States, was told by this man, the Reverend Bernard Gill, through another Western Union telegram, a year before he was appointed president, that he would be the next president, and he implored Gerald Ford to bring him down to Washington, D.C. to help get this nation back to the Lord before it is too late. As you can see from the verses that were written in the Bible, if a nation doesn't listen to God and do it his way, then a judgment will follow. And so that was the type of man and that I was describing to you. And as I told you, his photo was here on the front page of the church newsletter, which went out once a month. And this was the Macedonian call. At evening time it shall be light. And here he talked about prayer will raise the dead, And this was volume 1, number 10, that was sent out to all of the general superintendents of the Wesleyan movement and the Methodist churches and denominations and the Nazarene denominations and some of the Pentecostal denominations, superintendents of these organizations, Assemblies of God, Pentecostal churches, Nazarene churches, that was sent to students and staffs at hundreds of this newsletter, the Macedonian Call, staff and students at a lot of the Wesleyan movements, colleges all over the United States and the rest of the world that I spoke with you in previous programs about. And what he was saying was, now the things which I write unto you before God I lie not. Galatians chapter 1, verse 20, and Bernard Gill was the editor of this particular publication. And before I can read to you the 95 indictments against the Church of the Nazarene that he posted, like Martin Luther did 500 years earlier against the Roman Catholic Church, but this now in our time against the Church of the Nazarene and Protestantism, I wanted to further acquaint you with this particular theologian before we actually share with you on our programs the 95 indictments that he had posted with his Nazarene Church organization. Now, he in this question and answer of the Macedonian Call, I'll begin to introduce, expose you to a little bit of this so you can know where this man is coming from. Elijah's only gift was the gift of prayer. The question is, what does this mean? In the Old Testament, Elijah, in a question and answer here in this publication, the Macedonian Call, what does this mean? Elijah's gift, only gift was the gift of prayer. And the answer was, it was to let you know that even if what people say that the gifts of the Spirit do not operate today were true, the only gift you need is the power of prayer. Now, I know that when I'm talking to the saints of God and those that are born again, they you know, by reading your Bible, that there is great power in prayer. And that's prayer. Prayer continually is part of the children of God's life in studying the Bible. And see, Elijah, God performed many wonders through Elijah simply because he prayed the Lord of heaven to do so. And that was the power of prayer. The next question would be, wouldn't not those who reject the gifts of the Spirit being in operation today, they're called cessationists, who believe that these kind of gifts went out with the first century apostles. And they argue that the gifts of the Spirit, they reject the idea that these gifts of the Spirit would be in operation today, and have a tendency to take this statement has a defense for their position. Well, the answer to this is yes, some have already seized upon the statement, but Elijah lived under the law and not under grace, and he accomplished God's will with what he had. He neither denied it nor refused to use it. As you know, Elijah was a true worshiper of the Lord from heaven, and he prayed God to bring judgments upon idol worshiper, because, you know, the Ten Commandments, you're not supposed to have no other God before him. And Elijah was his prophet at that time, about 700, 800, 900 years before Christ. Elijah in the Hebrew monarchy, after King Solomon had died, there was a lot of wicked kings that caused the children of Israel to worship idol gods. And Elijah prayed the Lord, and judgments came because of Elijah's prayer upon his people. The next question is, this statement would be an encouragement to those who have no other gift. Like, some people have one gift, and that gift, that spiritual gift, is the gift of the power of prayer. But this would be an encouragement to those people who pray and have seen God answer prayers in their spiritual sojourn here on the earth, while they continue to pray and wait upon the Lord in his return. And they are to be encouraged when they read of such operations of God's Spirit back in that time of Elijah? And the answer to that question would be yes, it is. It is written, the Bible was written for God's children, both the Old Testament and New Testament, all 60 books. 66 books of the Holy Bible was written for you to read and to be encouraged. It was for your faith and for you to build up your most holy faith and for your instruction and for you to be encouraged. And that's why in the New Testament you're exhorted to pray, I believe, without ceasing. You're to always pray. As you know, when you're reading the Bible, that the Lord from heaven asked for a tenth of your income. That's a tithe. And knowing that the Lord likes us to give a tenth of our income to Him, how much time would one need to give the Lord to please Him and to be assured that one is actually being led of His Spirit and knowing what the Lord wants His child to do? Well, the answer was, if the Lord from heaven would want a tenth of your money, He would probably need at least a tenth of your time to walk with Him, read His Bible, and to talk with Him, like Enoch walked with God. And so you need, there's 24 hours in a day, you need to at least spend 2 hours walking and talking with God. Read His Word, pray, walk with Him, talk with Him, get along with Him. By so doing, the answer to that question would be, in any way one could hear the Holy Spirit, by spending time with Him, He would begin to lead you by reading like John chapter 14, 15, 16, and 17, Christ's high priestly prayer, and getting to know the Holy Spirit and spending time with Him in prayer. He can, in studying His Word, searching for ways to learn of Him, in any way the Holy Spirit can get through to you as you spend time with Him, would be the answer. So again, there are 24 hours in a day, and to exceed a tenth of that would be a minimum of 2.5 hours a day. Now, the Father up in heaven probably would expect you to spend at least a tenth. If He wants a tenth of your money, you should give Him at least a tenth or 2.5 hours a day, setting aside all your other activity and concentrating on your relationship with Him during this 2.5 hours time in a day. Now, one is beginning to speak of here, asking such questions to help us get the picture of why so many of the people in the organized churches today are not receiving leadings from the Lord, because they're not spending the needed time alone with Him so that He can, by His Holy Spirit, lead, guide, and direct them. There's probably very few doing this in the organized nominal Christian church today out of love. He wishes you to do this out of love. And the question would be asked with regard to prayer, would there be a list as to what the Lord from heaven would want to be doing with this time of 2.5 hours daily that he would be spending with the Lord, or a woman, or a boy, or a girl? And the answer in this question and answer says that yes, you can pray during this time. You can read the Holy Bible and other Christian publications that would encourage you to trust in the Lord to bring you out through all the different circumstances of life. Praying and asking God to lead and guide and direct you, implore the Holy Spirit to search your heart, take walks with God and wonder about the sin around you, and walk with the Lord and talk with Him about these concerns. And the list, it really is without end. You could continue to come to know the Lord in a more intimate way, a personal relationship with Him. This is probably why the Creator in intelligent design created man, so that man, His creation, would love Him. and spend time with him, get to know him. And the other question, are we always to pray to the Father in heaven, or would it be more correct to pray to his Son Jesus, or to his Holy Spirit? You know, God, the Holy Trinity, is three different people and three different beings, yet one God, like an egg. You've got the shell, you've got the white part and yellow part, but they're three different parts, but they're all one. Just like the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. And the answer to that question would be, all prayers of God's people are heard of him. And many times when you do pray, God may say yes for something, or God may say no, or God may say wait. It is not offensive to God the Father if some are prayed to the other two persons of the Godhead, the triune Godhead. Yes, you can pray to Jesus. He lives forevermore to intercede for you and to conform you into his image by the power of his Holy Spirit. Yes, you can pray to the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit indeed is involved in a progressive sanctifying way to conform you into the image of his Son and to get you ready to go to your eternal state of heaven. So it's okay to pray to not only the Father, but to the Son and to the Holy Spirit as well, so long as they are prayed to in the name of my Son, Jesus Christ, who is the Son of God, and also the Holy Spirit, that Jesus said, I go now to prepare a place for you. There are many mansions in my Father's house. If it were not so, I would not have told you. It's expedient for you that I go away, because if I go not away, the Comforter will not come. So indeed, it would be all right to pray not only to the Father in your prayer request, but petition the Son and his Holy Spirit as well. The question now is asking this Q&A, what did the 120 do in the upper room before Pentecost? And the answer is, they prayed and they prayed and they prayed. To truly pray, faith believing, is all that's required for a Pentecost, personal or public. And Matthew, in this Q&A, Matthew chapter 17, verse 21, howbeit this kind goeth not out but by prayer and fasting. Why could that be done by why could that only be done by prayer and fasting? And the answer is, because not all ills of sin are subject to just a word or a touch. Some are of such a magnitude as to require sacrifice on the part of God's people, lest it diminish the faith exercised in that way. Question, in Luke chapter 22, verse 44, and being in agony, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was, as it were, great drops of blood falling down to the ground. Would there be any answer to help us understand what we are supposed to, what thought is to be conveyed with regard to Christ praying here in the Garden of Gethsemane? And it says, it was exactly that. He had prayed, so great was his agony that his sweat was actually blood. This was no exaggeration of how much exaggeration. He sweat blood for man. The more you begin to understand this, the more you will sense a love in your heart for him, and how much he loved you and died for you to save you from your fallen, sinful condition. And then in Revelation chapter 6, verse 9, it says, I saw under the altar souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they hold. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, how long, O Lord, holy and true, dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth? What does it mean, under the altar? And the answer was, It means some wait under the altar for their suffering to be avenged. Can you conceive of those who loved so fully the Lord while they were on earth and were incapable of hate, being so cut through their souls upon arriving into heaven or the eternal state when you leave your body here in the earth, and realizing what was offered to those who killed them rather than take hold of the gift that God was trying to extend to them of eternal life, that they would pray for vengeance on these same ones for whom they prayed and whom they taught. This could not be done on God's holy altar up in heaven, so under it they wait and cry, "How long, O Lord, righteous and true, how long?" Such is the majesty of heaven, such is its grandeur to know. The eternal God was willing, but man was not. Remember John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever will," that means anybody, "oh, won't you accept him today?" The question, are these unhappy up in heaven at this time? And the answer from what was given to them in this publication sent to all the staff and students of the Wesleyan movement and the Pentecostal movement, like I told you before, the Assemblies of God and the Methodist Pilgrim Holiness churches and their Bible colleges, staff and students, and even the general superintendents of these denominations and Protestantism, it says, no, they weren't unhappy up there in heaven, not in the sense you would think unhappy. They are at times impatient up yonder for God's vengeance to fall, but not unhappy in heaven. No, 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 not unhappy in heaven. They are not unhappy in heaven, believe you me, according to this Q&A here. Now, the question was, have they been thus calling for vengeance from the time John wrote this revelation to this day, which is over 2,000 years now? And the answer is yes, they have, but not continually. And then the editor, Bernard Gill, of this church newsletter, the publication, as I said, the Macedonian Call, and you can see his picture here. It says, "Bernard Gill, God's prophet of the latter rain," in this Q&A of this church newsletter that he had wrote. Actually had an editor's comment, and it said, separate from the Q&A, he said, how easy we are today, how lukewarm. Yet the truth is that if you do not pray, God cannot work in a convicting way to save your loved ones from going to hell. So you're exhorted to remember to pray, pray without ceasing, that all your loved ones will come to know the Lord Jesus and see his face in peace, because you wouldn't want your loved ones to end up in an eternal hellfire for all eternity. And Paul wrote, "It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God." Paul said, "Because of the terror of the Lord, I persuade men." Won't some of you readers or hearers become intercessors? Won't you dedicate the rest of your lives to the salvation of the lost? And oh, won't you pray for full salvation of your loved ones and those that do not know him? Pray for a total surrender of their lives to God's will, like Jesus did in his example, praying in the Garden of Gethsemane, sweating drops of blood for man. Don't just pray until they make some public confession of faith in Christ, yet go on living as they please, but pray that they would become more and more like the good master, our Savior and Lord Jesus Christ. Well, my friends, it is time for me to close this particular session of Richard Allinger Presents Lessons in Church History. I'm so glad that you joined me, and I'm going to have to sign out now until the next session. So this is Richard Allinger saying goodbye, friends.